it is appropriate. You can always ask this from more than one person. You know, you can check, double check. Don't have to like only refer to one person. You can always refer to more than one. Now, just to make sure that you are in the right track. And obviously, methodology must be robust. As they say in others, it is deep and also big enough, I suppose, in a way that your data must have enough data so that whatever you use as your results are evidenced by the rich data that you have. It is not just superficial in others. Interpreting the results of your search is also very important. So, we couldn't emphasize more. In other words, what I'm telling you today is nothing new. It is something that you know about it. It's just that I'm just refreshing work, you know, what you're doing, and ensuring that you actually follow all this. In other words, what I'm trying to tell you is that whatever you have been told still applies. Of course, in terms of discussion, it's up to you how you want to do your discussions. It depends on the research paper you are doing. Some research paper requires more discussion, more group interviews and so forth than others. So it depends on what research you are doing. What they are doing now here to say that if it requires your group interviews and focus groups and all that, you have to undertake it. There's no shortcut. Finally, in your conclusion, make sure that you present a global and specific conclusion. The end of the paper should actually answer the original question. What is it that you wanted to find out? So have you found out whatever you want to find out? Were you able to apply some of the theories and practice as well? And also state the limitations of your research, what you can do, and what you believe further research can do as well, what further research can be done. But do not summarize your paper. The abstract is for this. Your conclusion is just a conclusion. It's not an abstract. An abstract is an abstract. So shouldn't confuse it too. Yeah? In your conclusion, don't start to introduce a new topic. Because it's very concluding your research. So don't really start something new, something like something different in other words. They also don't want you to make some obvious statements. Obvious statements means you don't have to say it. People know what it is. But so try not to write sort of like adding more words, more sentences. And lastly, don't contradict yourself. All these things can happen when you're writing, because sometimes you may not be aware of it. So that's why it's always good that before you send your paper for publication, you should get it peer reviewed. Get someone to read it. Very, very important. If you want to get someone to read your paper, who do you think you should approach to read your paper before you send it online submission? Who do you think you want to read your paper? Your best friend? When is your best friend? No, what?
Because you say this article is good and you will never say
it. You give it to your enemy? Right?
Something
English. Right. Don't take it so seriously. Okay. Anyway, you're right. You don't want to give it to your best friend, as you say. Sometimes if you overlook and say, it's okay, just send it in. I think it's one of your best papers. Or if you get to someone whom you don't like, they say, this is rubbish, okay? Don't even bother. So, both ways, not good enough. So, I had a suggestion to say, why don't we give an expert, someone in your area, expertise? Like, for example, Professor So-and-so, who is very good at it. And assuming you managed to gain the services of this professor, in other words, you went to see me and said, hi, Prof, I've been doing this, I understand you are going to see it. Is it okay if you have a look at my paper, just go through it and see if it's okay before I submit it. And assuming Prof was in a very good mood, said, yes, fine, give it then, I'll do it. There are a couple of things you need to do after that. What do you think you need to do? Once the prof says yes, then what do you need to do? It seems obvious, no? You have to tell him. Because don't forget, no? The prof is a very busy person. Okay? So you need to tell him when you want it back. Number two, you have to tell him when you can go and see him before that date. After all, the date is supposed to be end of May. No? So if you tell professor, hey prof, is it okay if beginning of April I come and see you, prepare you, then kalau ada apa-apa, you won't tell me, you tell me then, you know, the kind of thing. Because you know that your paper you need to submit very soon already. So you don't want to like have to do major revision again. It's very important that you do those things. Because if not, this is what's going to happen. When you go there at the end of May, right, Prof? Yes? Prof, my paper, you know? Paper. Yeah, you remember that day I came and left you the paper and you said, okay, you can look for me, and I told you I need it at the end of May, that's why I'm back. You know, suddenly your heart, you know, from where it sank, that went down there, you know. And then you don't know what to do. You don't know where to jump into the Sungai or go somewhere else, you know. So, therefore, don't let it happen to you. And it's not his fault, by the way. I already told you he's a very easy person. So you have to keep in touch with him. You have to hassle him now again. Because you want his opinion anyway. What to do? So what does it mean? Just like in a beauty contest, you know, and anywhere you go, don't always go for the winner. Why? I mean, say you're a talent scout, you know, maybe singing contest or beauty contest, whatever. Don't always go for the winner. Why? Because the winner always have to take on a very big action, you know, and then Maha juga, you know, kalau this advertisement is also like, always go for the runner. Well, runner up will always say, hey, I did get winner, but you want me, oh, I go, you know, because now I got chance to. So even for your paper, I would suggest, go for someone whom you know is aspiring to be a professor. Aspiring to want to go up, he don't mind, he or she don't mind being a paper and doing wonderful job. Seriously. Okay, huh? Very quickly, how much time? About 20 minutes. Okay. Let's carry on. When you're writing, try to avoid generalizations, meaning that you put down there the words like as a rule, for the most part, generally, potentially, normally, these are words which means in general. Try to avoid. Sometimes we have to use it, but try to avoid. Why? Why do you want to avoid words like this in this generalization? Yeah, because it's not specific. It's not specific in it. It's just like, I haven't done any research. I can always say, you know, in general, it's like this, whatever is like that. Yeah, like that's not what we know. But your research, what does it say? It must be more specific. That means your research must communicate what is it that you have done and specifically within the parameters, what has happened. You cannot say like in general, you know. That means what I'm saying is that to the reader is like you have not done any research. Because you could have made that statement without doing any research, seriously. So try and avoid those kind of wordings. Yeah? Okay. Next. This one is for those who are like to use idioms, in English, not idioms. Macam dia kata, speak of the devil. That one for conversation, okay, like colloquialism, for conversation, okay, you can always say that. But when you write, what? Jangan use words like this. Or phrases like this? For many reasons. One is it's not academic kind of writing, yeah? Secondly is it could be something that reader don't understand. It could be particular maybe for a certain culture, people understand what it is, but for others they don't know what they're talking about. So try and not use that. Always use an active voice in your writing, okay? Rather than passive. Okay, what do you mean by active? For example, it says down there, the university employs researchers as opposed to researchers are employed by the university. Can you see the difference? One is active and one is passive. Active means that you have someone then initiating it, and then the action word, and then the object. Don't go and reverse it the other way around. When you reverse the other way around, you become passive. So try and write in an active voice in your paper. Okay, there are certain ethics that you have to follow. For Emerald, we are part of COPE, okay, which is the publication ethics. Okay, committee on publication ethics, we are a member of that. So we expect our authors to be the same as well. So you have to choose the right journal in the first place, okay, problematic. In ours, now that you are ready with the research, the next thing is that you want to publish it in a journal. So you must know which journal to publish in. Choosing a journal is extremely important. It is, how shall I say, the next important thing apart from writing is choosing the right journal. So as I said, try and do a good research on journals in terms of the subject area. Look at the subject area first. That means if your research is about marketing, then look at the marketing portfolio of journals. Don't look at other things. Just look at marketing. Okay? There are quite a number of publishers which do marketing journals. So look at each and every one of them. And then for each of these journals, go to the journal website and look for the objective and see whether your research paper is similar or something to do with the objective of this journal. Is that what they are looking for? If it is not, just pass. Next. Don't waste time. So you must get to the journal where your research paper meets with your objective. That's your journal. Now, once when you identify that, normally you might come to two or three journals, you know, which you think, this one also can, this one also can, you know, that kind of thing. So you may have two or three. Now, the next thing you do is to then download one or two articles from each journal and read it. Read the article, just don't download and simpan dalam file. So you must read it. And why do you download the articles from each journal to read? Why? Why do you want to do that? Yes. Why? Not just referring, but also to read to see the expectation from this journal. I see they write it this way, and this is what they want, that's why this article got published. That means you are now looking at your own paper, and then you're looking at the published paper. Is yours something like this? If you say, oh, it's very different, then maybe that's not the right journal, or maybe you have to change the format of the paper, or whatever. You get what I'm saying? In other words, reading the article of the journal gives you an expectation of what you should have. Enough similar to, so that you have an idea. So don't just send it in just like that. All these things I'm telling you is to increase your success. To increase your success of publication. Yeah. And talking about where to some of you may have been told, I've come across certain universities where the lecturers were told, when you publish a paper, it must be an ISI rank. Atau Scopus, atau apa. Yang lain tak boleh. Ataupun, if you do publish in other journals, then no brownie points. Other promotion, other bonus, other holiday, other. So if you are in that category, then I got to say, sorry lah, then you have to look for all the journals. So in Emerald, we have more than 200 titles in the Scopus index. In Emerald, we have 50 over in ISI. So you mentioned what you want. But we have 100% of our journals are international peer reviewed journals. What the last sentence is means you want to publish your paper at least in an international peer reviewed journal, if it's not ISI or what. In other words, don't hold back because the journal that has accepted your paper is not ISI ranked journal. Why I say that is at the end of the day, it's a number of articles you have published in an international peer reviewed journal. Just in case you was not aware, in your CV, you actually put in your publication. You know that, right? Yeah. Where you publish, which article, So if you are looking for ISI rank journal only, can light up now. Okay? But you got good paper, but you don't want, you hold back, and then you keep sending or whatever, and then after 2 years, don't publish like that. Somebody else have already written 2 or 3 papers during the time and published in international peer-reviewed journals. Not just any journal, international. What do you mean by international peer-reviewed? That means it goes through the peer-review process, okay, very important, and is internationally distributed. This person will then be able to say, I published 3 papers in whatever. And the other person can only say, I tried this journal, I know this ISI journal, but I tried, I still couldn't tell me anything. So what? You get my point. At the end of the day, it's what you publish that counts. Right? So, be strategic. These are the areas that we are looking at, rankings in terms of Thomson Reuters ISI, they look at impact factors, then other Scopus, other H index, and then you look at the usage, peer perception. These are all the things that people do consider when they are looking at which journal to publish in. You will come across your colleagues, I can assure you, your colleagues will say, hey, this journal, I've read it, it's very good. I know it's not ISI, but very good. This one you can get published in this journal, or that. Or even your professor will tell you so. Okay? Take note of all those comments, because that is a peer perception. That's important. Okay, quickly, I go to ISI. I tada my master lagi, only 10 minutes. So, sorry I take up so much of your time, but do you all want to know about ISI ranking now? Yeah? Okay. Let's go. The ISI, very quickly, I'm the only way to go quickly is talk very fast. Dr. Eugene Garfield, over 50 years ago, actually came up with this ISI ranking thing. It was bought over by Thomson Reuters, who took it over from him. Basically what Garfield did was that at that time, scientific journals, these medical journals, pharmaceutical, engineering, and all these other scientific journals, do not have any set of criteria to say whether this journal is good or not. Why should I subscribe to this journal? Why should I look at this journal? Why should I refer to this journal? So this guy, Garfield, came up with a checklist, a criteria, to say that this journal may not okay. What do you mean? So he has a criteria. I don't have to set a criteria with me, but what he uses is impact factor. He uses an impact factor to indicate how impactful this journal is in terms of readership and citations. So he bases a lot of citations. So he has come up with this criteria, a ranking as he calls it, where it's based on the number of citations this journal has. That means the more citations, the better it is, obviously. Okay? So what he did was to calculate the impact factor for ISI ranking. No? That means if you say your ISI rank, that means you have gone through this process whereby they look at your criteria, everything, and then they will give you an impact factor. Now, how do they calculate this impact factor? By looking at a three-year period. So, for example, if you are looking at 2013, you'll go back to 2012 and 2011 data. Okay, taking this as an example, by the way, there's no journal of Newcastle Business School in the other new makeup. And for 2010, they have to go back to 0809. So when they look at 0809 for this journal, they found that there were 16 articles published during that time. But they also look at the citations for this journal during the 2 years. Citations meaning that the articles that were published in that journal were cited. And where are these citations from? These citations must be from ISI ranked journals. Look at non-ISI. Non-ISI, they want to know. Because the articles in that journal could be cited by a lot of other journal articles. And if they are not ISI ranked, they want to know only because practical terms, they would not know. How would they know? There's so many journals out there. You mean you can track each and every one of them? How? They don't have the kind of resource. So they only look at those ISI rankings. Those ISI rankings under them, they know they are tracking them because they're under ISI. So under any ISI ranked journal, if they cite this journal, then the citations become part of the calculation. So they just need to know how many citations during the 2 years. So when they look at it, they found that, okay, in this 2 year, there were 60 articles and 20 citations. There were only 20 citations for this particular journal in the 2 years from ISI ranked journals. So they tested the 20 divided by the 60 articles that were published, they get an impact factor of 0.3. That's how they get an impact. I can assure you that of all the ISI ranked journals by Thompson, 70% or more are all scientific journals. The social sciences only make up 20-25%. That's why when you look at the social sciences, you know, humanities and all those kinds of subject areas, don't have many ISI ranked journals. Whereas the scientific journals, a lot of it is ISI ranked because it's meant for that. Therefore, when you look at impact factor for scientific journals, they're quite high because a lot of it comes from their own ISI ranked. So therefore, it is quite obvious that if you look at a social science journal like management or marketing or whatever, if they are ISI ranked, their impact factor normally is not very high. If you get a 2, impact factor of 2 is considered very good already. So that's how you look at it. Yep. Okay, before I talk about the rest, is that okay for ISI? At least you have some understanding. The other things that people look at apart from ISI, of course, is Scopus. Okay, Scopus is done by Elsevier, which is the publisher. So Elsevier actually publishes that. ABS is actually Association of Business Schools in the UK. So the UK Business School also have their own ranking. And then IRA is actually Excellence in Research in Australia, which is now not so active now because it's by the government, by the way. And the government is taking a less active role. And ABDC is actually the Association of the Business Deans Council. Business Deans Council in Australia. Okay. So the Business Deans Council actually decide on which are the journals that they will regard as highly ranked. Just to let you know, this journal of ours have got an A plus in the ABDC. A plus is about the highest. Next. Publishing things, do not submit to more than one journal at one time. So if you got one research paper, don't send to journal A, journal B, journal C. Same paper. At the same time, I mean, today you send this, tomorrow you send that, next day you send that. Why? Okay, ma, my paper was one. But who said I can't send it? No, that's not what it is. That's why you call it publishing. It's ethics. It's like a professional ethics. If you don't do things like that. You see, if you happen to do that, and all the three publishers reject your paper, nothing happens. Nothing happens. It's not too bad. Nobody wants your paper. But if two out of the three accept your paper, what do you know? I just want to let you know, the editor may be editing a certain journal from a certain publisher, and then this one from a different publisher, they're two forms responsible for me. They know each other. I'm going to show you that. They know each other. So they will refer. Hey, you also got this paper. Hey, here's the paper. How? Copyright? You are in trouble already. You cannot publish in two different journals. So at the end of the day, you may have to choose one, right? So you choose one. And then what happens to the other one who has accepted? Next time you send, you know what they do, put the big X there. They publish it, so you don't do that. However, if your paper was already rejected by publisher A, and then you want to send to publisher B, okay, no problem. Don't care. Or even if publisher A didn't reject you, they send it back for revision. Okay, you could not revise it here. For some reason, you don't want, you know. So you can revise and send it to publisher B. Okay. This is the one talking about plagiarism. Plagiarism is, I think you all know, So you mystery give credit and references to those people who you use their work. You have to do it properly, So they got different styles, Harvard referencing and all that. So whatever it is, you have to give credit, okay? Don't forget. Because as a publisher, if the editor suspect that your work is plagiarized, you're plagiarizing the same work, they will actually get us to do a software called Authenticate. We will actually put your paper to this, and the outcome will be, it will tell us where and how many of these plagiarism that we have done. And now, where did that take place, and which are the sentences or which are the phrases that we have used? So, in which case, two things will happen. Either we will reject it, which we just say sorry, one, or we will tell you to do something about it. If your paper is really good, it could be a human error. Sometimes you don't know. You know why it happens sometimes when I say don't know, but go. Because you do so much research. You read so many things. Just on definition alone, you already refer to about 10 or 12 different articles or whatever, just on definition alone. So later on, you come up with your own definition. And there's a good chance that your own definition actually will capture or have words that belong to somebody else or phrases. So very be careful. Okay. Copyright, as you all know. So when you all do your research, the copyright will be with us. You have to sign the copyright agreement. Kalau you say no, I don't want to sign, then you cannot publish. Okay, so you have to sign for us to publish. You must have a copyright. This one, can we just pass? I did say this one that you have to send for peer review before you send it in. There's a spot the error one. Spot the error. A new research methodology introduced in 2007. Can you tell me what is the error there? new, that's not quite right, grammatically, that was not right, yeah? Why we are pointing this out to you very quickly, yeah? Some of you may be using spell check for your research paper. We just want to highlight to you, spell check, bukan grammar check. This one, spell check will say absolutely okay, no problem. But grammar, so spell check is not grammar check, remember that. Okay. After submission, only three things can happen, yeah? Okay. Anyway, when you send it in, by the way, everything is online now. Journal or online submission. You just go to the journal website, you click on it, they will take you to the online submission. You have to fill in a form, you know. You have to fill it in and then you can send it in there itself. Okay? So you go to the journal website. And for those of you who want to know how long it takes, normally the editor, assuming if he's in town and he's not on sabbatical or he's not away on holidays or whatever, he will take 1 week to go through a paper to say whether he's going to accept it. If not, he will send it back to you straight away. If he does, he will search up for two reviewers to look at the paper. And the reviewers can take up to 6 to 8 weeks to look at the paper. And this is also an assumption that he is able to find the two reviewers within a week. Sometimes cannot. Why I say that is because he may have a big network of reviewers, but the reviewers may all be very busy. So if they are busy, they will say, sorry, I can't do it for you. Then he will search for another person. So therefore, it takes time. Right? And assuming if everything goes according to the way we think it should be, you are taking about 3 to 4 months after you submit online. And at the end of 3 or 4 months, what happens normally is that your paper will be sent back for some revision. Question is major or minor revision at all. So you will get it back. If for whatever reasons, after 4 months, you did not hear senior, that's the time you write to me. You write to me, you let me know when you send the paper, the title of the paper, which journal and so forth, I'll follow up for you. But only emerald students. Yang lain, I boleh buat. Okay. Yep, correct. Okay, except reject revise, huh? What happens if your paper is rejected? Don't give up. That's the first thing I'll tell you. Don't give up. Everyone has been rejected before. Every one of us. For some, whatever things that we have done before, whether it was your first date or second date or first girlfriend, first boyfriend, all got rejected before, right? Okay. Anyway, for this one, if you are rejected once, that's okay. Huh? But more importantly, is that you have to ask why and listen carefully in terms of the feedback that you get from. Why was yours rejected? It could be as simple as you sent to the wrong journal. That's it. That means it's nothing to do with your paper. Your paper, okay. Tapi you sent wrong journal. So some editors will actually recommend you, okay, why do you send to whatever journal? Some may not, because they may not be aware of. Yeah? So you must try again. Don't give up. Yeah? Because you've done so much work, don't give up if it's rejected. Because even the best papers that were written by professors, they have been rejected before. So there's something new in other words. Keep trying. Then we find out, like, okay, Carol rejected, apart from sending to the wrong journal, what else? Okay, it's because they don't follow up the guidelines. This is back, this feedback that we get from editors. And the lack of faith, that means it doesn't follow what the objective is. Okay? The objective of this journal, the papers that they want, is supposed to be this, but you got something else. And then in terms of the methodology and all that, yes, that could be a reason as well. It could be the contribution to the body of knowledge that is not sufficient, it's only very superficial or incremental. In other words, it's not a significant contribution. And do you understand? a journal conversation, basically what they're saying is that, have you read some of the articles that we have been publishing in this journal? Is yours something like that? This slide, I actually took it from one of the editors I was working with. So he used this slide, so I put him say, I cannot borrow your slide, is sure? So he wrote this down. In his, he's the editor of the, one of our journals called Islamic Market Network. And he actually told me, the theory based on market analysis is dated. That means it's outdated. When they use the word dated, it means outdated. That means it's not recent. They want the latest, but you didn't have. The conceptualization itself is weak. That means you don't have a big idea. You're only looking at a very small part of it. The level and depth of discussion is shallow. They actually want more discussion, more in-depth in terms of group interviews, focus groups, whoever you look at, and the data collection must be a little bit more rigorous. And some of them are unable to apply the findings to theory and practice. In other words, we want you to look at what you have concluded and how does this affect, as I was saying earlier on, the impact that you have on one of those six areas. And sometimes your presentation lacks priority, that means it is not robust, it is not, how should it, it doesn't have a flow, you know. So it's very important to have that. More importantly is that, is it a compelling read? Let me explain to you what compelling read very quickly. Have you all ever come across where you buy a book? It could be a book, it could be a magazine, it could be just an article, where you take it, and you read it and you don't want to let go of it. Even when you eat, you're still reading it. Sometimes when you go to hunger, also you'll be reading it. When you are going to sleep, you still want to read it. That kind of thing. You get what I'm saying? That is what a compelling read is. Compelling read means you can't leave it. You just want to keep reading it. Question now is your paper like this? If you feel that your paper is like this, a compelling read, means people read it, they don't want to let it go, that means you've got it already. You've done it. In terms of percentages, we are looking at 100% submission and about 29 to 30% published. So that's the kind of average that we are looking at. Therefore, do not despair or do not feel disheartened if yours is not in the 30%. Always try again. It could be a different journal, it could be a paper could be revised from all sorts of things. Yeah? So don't give up. One of the things that we suggest to do by this particular editor is that you can form teams across industries. That means try and not just sit in an armchair and say and do armchair research, but go out, talk to people, make friends with everybody, with industry, with even competitors, with anybody to get more information so that the data that you collect for your research becomes more rich, so to speak. Don't just confine yourself to maybe just one database or so. I mean, there are a lot of databases, there are a lot of journals for you to read. There are more than one way of doing research, actually. Don't forget that observation is a very, very important part of research. So again, do all this. In other words, do everything that you need to do to get the research that you want so that your research becomes a quality research. It is not just desk research, so to speak. It's more than that. Be proud of those kind of data that you collect. When you have a revision, it means good news. Huh? That doesn't mean the revision is bad. Revision means you just need you to do this revised part and then you will get published. So take very seriously about it. When you receive a paper from the editor where it's supposed to be revised, first thing you're going to do is acknowledge the editor. Just write back, email to the editor and say, thank you very much for sending back my paper for revision. I have now taken note of the things that you want me to revise. Now if any of the things that the editor wants you to revise and you're not clear about, you're not sure, please clarify it with the editor. Do not assume. And the things that you need to revise, you can consult with the colleagues, you can consult with anybody who can help you with that revision. It doesn't mean that you have to do it all alone. This is not an exam. Get the best help that you can for your revision. And try to meet the deadline. If they say you must send this paper back at a certain time, please do so. If not, please let the editor know. And finally, when you send back your revised paper, do have a covering letter. And in that covering letter, you should be writing down, dear editor, based on the revision checklist that you wanted me to do, the first one was about my reference list and that you wanted me to add in so and so. I have now done it and it's on page 29. You know, if you let the editor know where you have done your revision, so that the editor can quickly go and check out and make sure that you have done it and then that's it. This is just a letter. And of course, when it's accepted, it's congratulations for hard work. Typical editor comment is that in all the years that he has been editor, he has not accepted a single paper or first submission. In other words, at best, it will be revised. When you have got your paper published, you will be written to, the editor will write to you and say that the paper will be published, when it will be published, and so on. So you will actually get to know. Once when it's published, it will go to our early site. It will be in our database already, in the early site. That's part of the the features of the database we have early site. And then only later on, the actual print paper will come up. So it will come up in the digital form first, and then it will come up here. And when it does, that means your article is inside this issue, right? You will be sent this particular issue and also a PDF copy of your actual article for you. However, this may be for this year. I'm not sure next year whether they continue to do it. I'm not sure. Okay. Because they're thinking of cutting off print. But for the moment, it's still on. So you get it. Please do promote your paper, and we really mean it. We don't mean you to be macam very arrogant, because the other extreme is this one. Bila you dapat di article inside, kan? So the other extreme is whereby you take this printed copy and then you walk around the campus slowly and slowly, so that people look at you and say, okay, don't have to do all that, right? Because you know why? Your university have your own in-house newsletter, your in-house bulletin, whatever. So you can inform the editor of that blog, yeah? And actually tell them about your paper, the title, the abstract, and all that. So you have your own blog site, you can also tell people about that you have just published an article in this journal and so on. In other words, we want you to promote your own work. If you're a faculty member, you can actually use it and basically your students have to read it, you know, whatever. Why do we want you to do that? Because we want you to be proud in the right way, yeah, of your work, of what you've done. Don't forget, you spent so much of time, sweat, blood and tears, as they say. Not really blood, but you know, sweat, tears. You cannot, like, somebody was telling me, you know, this person has already published, by the way, it's in USN, published. And then another friend can say, hey, you know that day, I read the journal, there's an article, huh? Was it you, you wrote the article?
I wrote sometime ago,
You know, like, macam, nothing, like, wrong. It's something, how can it be nothing? You get what I'm saying? So be proud of that. So you promote, yeah, in any way that you can. Right. Thank you. And, finally, I'd like to summarize by saying, this publication, your presentation very important. Understand your target market, who you are publishing for, your audience, in other words, be ethical, which we have talked about. Learn the review process, how your work is being reviewed, in collaboration with your co-authors and so forth. Check and check again, attention to detail, take your time, involve your peers. Your work must be original, of course, and then you must want to promote your work and now spread the work. So that's how we would like you to remember publication time. Okay, these are some of the websites that you go to. First one is ISI, second one is Hamzah, it's by Andrew Hamzah, which is a professor in Melbourne University, who actually came up with her own set of criteria as well for doing these journals, and she also supplied the citations also. Scopus, of course, Campbell is just a directory, and the other two are not so important for you. Yeah. So that's my details. If you need to contact me, I have, if you all have taken the folder, there's one brochure for the e-journals, one for the book series, and then a summary, and then a feedback form. I would like you to fill in the feedback form if you don't mind. And most important in your feedback form is your email address. Please supply us with your email address. Reason is because we want to keep in touch with each and every one of you. Okay, so that when you write to me, I am aware of who you are as well. So, are there any questions? Other questions? Other question, I have there. Okay. Can someone tell me how long Emerald has been in publishing? Berapa tahun? Okay, Charizard. Berapa tahun?
Three or four others, you know what their name are? At all, correct.
Your name is at all. No more name. Okay. One more. Can you tell me one more thing that you all have to do? If you are... one more thing you have to do. One more thing you have to do as a co-author, if you are co-authors. Okay, we talk about name, it must be in order, right? There's one thing very important, right at the top. As co-authors, you all must do is make sure that that happens. So the looper,
Next, the 2013 Literary Award for Outstanding Paper goes to Dr. Nur Hazmi M. Noor, Dr. Tajul Aris Yam, Mr. Noor A. Fabianto, and Mr. K. B. Ramayandaran, with paper entitled Muslim Attitude and Awareness Towards Istihalah, published in Journal of Islamic Medicine. Last but not least, the 2013 Literary Award for Outstanding Paper goes to Dr. Muhammad Zulkifli Abdullah and Mr. Chun Sean Lau with paper entitled Three-Dimensional Thermal Investigations at Board Level in a Reflow Oven Using Thermal Coupling Method, published in Soldering and Surface Mount Technology. Congratulations to all award winners. Give them a round of applause.